Hey everybody, how are you guys today? Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you guys for being here. I appreciate you. And I see all the links that I so lovingly dropped earlier have now disappeared. Child, listen. It's all right. It's okay. So, how is everybody today? Okay. It has been quite the day. I hope you guys are doing okay. I appreciate you guys showing up in here. I'm just gonna drop these links. Y'all give me 1 second to do that. I'm trying to go through as quickly as I can to get her done. It's all right. These things happen. I think if you go through and drop the links too early, then by the time you go live, child, listen, stuff be disappearing. And you be looking like you ain't dropped nobody's links nowhere. And I don't want to do that. Okay. So I was trying to do my due diligence, child, and do it early. But apparently, that's the way this lady I used to watch on YouTube, she sounded just like my late mother. But apparently, this lady's not on YouTube anymore. She moved over to her channel is still up, but she doesn't put any content over here anymore. She is so done with YouTube. I think they did her dirty, so she decided to move on. All right, I think y'all excuse me, that I have dropped all of the links. Let me see. Give me 1 second. Minute. Child, I think that's everybody. Let me make sure, because I don't want to be wrong. Oh, let me see. One moment, please. Please wait. Don't you hate when you call customer service and they do that to you? Okay. All right, got it. All right, so hey y'all, hey. We are back in business around these parts. Let me turn off these ringtones and notifications, child. Thank you guys for your continued patience with our organization. I hate when they say that. Thank you for your continued patience. Right. All right. Hey. Y'all show some love to my moderators, Evelyn, Love Jones, ICUR Family, and Bikini Body Challenge. They work hard to keep us safe in the speakeasy. So mind your manners, lest you get blasted. All right, make sure you like, share, comment, and subscribe. And if you are on the replay, thank you so much for visiting the speakeasy. We hope you will subscribe and come on back again and again and hopefully catch a live stream. All right, so like, share, comment, subscribe to my channel. Yes, thank you. All right, let me see who's here. Hey, family, that's my Irish twin sniper. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. We've got Mother Black Diamond in the building. Welcome, love. Thank you for being here. We appreciate you sliding through the speakeasy and gracing us with your presence. All right. Happy all day with her happy all day ass. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. You do know I'm gonna say that every time you show up. So just get ready. It's happening. It's a thing now. It's a thing. This is the nature of our relationship because we are in a relationship. And that's what I'm going to say every time I see you. All right. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Bikini Body Challenge is in the building. That's my little sneaky laughing sniper. You know how she get down. Thank you for being here, darling. Welcome, welcome. She gonna give a sneaky laugh before she snipe your ass. We like it like that. All right, let me see who else is here. Me with all of the links. All right, I think. Uh-oh, no. Choco Chip is in the building. Welcome, love. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. And happy all day. Well, her happy all day ass said, I just subscribe to everybody. All right. Thank you, darling. I appreciate you. See, it actually works when people subscribe. Thank you, darling. Hey, Choco Chip. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. House of the Princess in the building. Thank you, darling, for gracing us with your presence, darling. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Yes, we have to support Black women, you guys. We have to support. Okay, let me fix that. We have to support supportable Black women. Right. We have to support Black women that are not on trash bag behavior. Okay? That's what we're doing over here. Yes, God. So thank you, Princess, for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. All right, so listen, y'all didn't come in here to hear me talk to y'all about supporting Black women. Well, that's all, the whole reason for this channel, but whatever. So we're here to read the next four chapters. So let's get to getting. All right, chapter 17. This time, Petra knocked. Good for her. She couldn't have walked right in anymore. I had removed the towel, but left the chair in the jammed, locked position. I guessed this was their morning, although I didn't know how anyone down here tells time. It felt like I had stayed up all night. Who knows? I did know that it was time to put what I had stayed up scheming on into action. I removed the chair and opened the door gently. Come on in, I told her nicely. I can't. I have to wake up all of the other girls in time for the gathering in the sanctuary, she said. But then she looked at my hair. You changed your hair. It looks pretty. I washed it. Thanks for the clean water. That was for your face, she explained. I use the water in the basin to wash my hair and the water in the pitcher to clean my face and hands. Don't you all have a bathroom and shower in this big place? I asked. The water in the pitcher was for you to drink. I see you are very creative and like to do things your own way. She stepped inside after saying she wouldn't. She looked around. And you have hemmed your dress and embroidered your name across your breast. That should be fine for today, but you will have to do as each soul must do. Nobody here really stands out. We are each here for the same purpose. She turned to leave after her careful inspection. I see you are barefoot. Your socks are in the drawer with the slippers. Please put them on before you come out. I only have one sock, I lied. Really? How could that be? She asked, but I did not reply. Okay, I'll get you a new pair. She left. I had used one sock to do my hair. It was some old school Brooklyn shit. When I was like 12 years young, we used a tube top like a headband and folded the hair around the tube top to create the hairstyle that I have now. If you know what you are doing and do it right, no one can see the tube top, headband, or in this case, sock. Of course, I did it right. I prefer to rock a bun or a ponytail, but succubus had torched half of my hair. Only a few inches of it had grown back so far. She returned with the socks in a jiffy. You never answered me about the bathroom, I reminded her as she tried to hurry out. Of course, we do have a few bathroom and shower facilities, but everybody's first night here is the same. Each body gets washed and examined by the nuns upon arrival. It's all for our protection. You'll get the tour after the gathering in the sanctuary. Do you work here? I asked her. Yes, was all she said back. How long have you been working here? 1 Earth year. Now, I do have to go. It was good enough information for me for now. Really, I was just testing her, seeing how either secretive or flexible she was. I did want to know if this was her job, though. That grandmother Maria, who they call Mother Maria, had said that Petra used to be in my same situation. Now, I know it is possible to upgrade from being a charity case to having a job in this convent. If I could get one, I would use it. Oh, this thing is jumping. To collect information, gain access, and buy time to set my real business in motion. Once I get to know all of the women here and all of their stories, talents, assets, and traits, I could use it to get whatever I wanted out of each of them. I was accustomed to shaking down new prisoners on lockup. I would find out where they were from, what crimes they were convicted for, how much they had in their commissary, if they had any relatives or visitors who would be coming upstate on a regular. Plus, I was checking if they was about the streets and the hustle, if they could get people to bring shit on a visit that I ordered and would buy from them. Of course, other details Like, are they related to any cops or corrections officers in the prison where we were locked? I was going to play it the same way here. I stayed up all night memorizing that boring ass Lord's Prayer. I even ended up having to crack open that dictionary that Sadiqa had stashed in the inside pocket of my saddlebag. I didn't like the flow of their prayer. It used weird words that, as far as I know, are never spoken like thy and thine and hallowed. I looked up hallowed. The dictionary said it means sacred. Then I had to look up sacred just to be sure. The definition of sacred was a bit strange. It said pertaining to God, secured against violation. So the line in the prayer, hallowed be thy name, which I thought meant that the name is hollow, which would mean empty, actually means sacred is your name. Seems the asshole who wrote the prayer should have just said it plainly, unless he just didn't want anybody to understand on purpose. Not everybody is going to take the time to look all these words up. And besides, the prayer starts off talking about our father. I was like, whose father? Not mine. Maybe that works on people who ain't got parents or memories. If I could pray to Santiago, my prayer would be the sincerest, most influential words in existence. No other who heard them would dare say they didn't understand. They'd feel such word, I'm sorry, they'd feel each word pumping in their veins, thumping in their hearts. Then there was a line in the Lord's Prayer like, give us our daily bread. To that line, I was like, every fool, dead or alive, knows that no one just gives you shit. They would have been better off saying, give us jobs so we can earn some paper and feed ourselves. Even though I didn't like the prayer, I could recite it. I plan to impress this old chick in charge and pretend to gobble up all of their gobbledygook. They would in turn let me keep this rent-free room, get me a job assignment and access. After I got paid, and soon as I was set up right, I'd bounce like I was never even here. Who wants to volunteer to lead us in the Lord's Prayer today? Grandma Maria said. My hand shot up like I was an eager fifth grader. She chose me. I walked from the rear of the sanctuary in my Prada kicks and upgraded altar dull gray garment. I pretended not to hear the comments as I whizzed by, all eyes on me. The key to grabbing control of a scene is to be so good at whatever you do that everyone there wants to be you. Once they want to be me, that's when they become either my customer or my victim. I tripped. The gathered gasped. I almost fell on my face, but caught myself before humiliation. When I regained my footing, I looked back. All of the women's faces were feigning innocence. I knew one of them stuck their foot out. Are you okay? One of the grandmothers walked over to escort me like I was some cripple. I'm fine, I said, controlling my anger. When I reached the front, I found myself facing about 150 or so women who were all seated on long rows of wooden benches. Also, there were the ones who remained standing on both the left and right side, or left and right aisle. What am I seeing words that aren't here? I saw Petra standing. I assumed then that the other women who were standing were also young corridor captains and staff. The grandmothers were up front. I saw their eyeballs roaming over my overnight version of their garment. Grandmother Maria, because I'd be damned if I call her Mother Maria, she ain't my goddamn mother, had her eyes fixed on my feet. I wasn't wearing the cheap Chinatown type flat slip-ons that came with the garment or the paper slippers. Of course, I have to draw the line somewhere, even when I'm skinny. I will never, ever be a cheap shoe-wearing bitch. But just then, when I looked down at my own feet, I saw a scuff mark from almost tripping. That got me pissy. I played it off. Our Father, who art in heaven, I announced and projected. I was so confident, the type of confidence that comes when you don't know none of the people who surround you and they don't know you either. I would impress, use, and discard. Hallowed be thy name. They all repeated after me. That's when I saw one mouth that wasn't moving. She was standing there in the aisle where I almost fell. Her arms were folded across her chest. Across her chest. It was the pretty young bitch who I bit when I was a dog, the same one who was getting fucked right by that nigga before she turned into a rat, the same one who came and sat next to me at the UBS rally of the Suns. I was careful to not let my expression acknowledge her. Game face on. Thy kingdom come, I said. I even began giving eye contact to let the grandma see clearly that I was not reading from a card or a paper. I learned it by heart. I'm useful. Hire me. Thy will be done. I said at full volume, on earth as it is in heaven. Once I completed the prayer, a long line formed in each aisle. I was surprised to find out that it was a line for hugs. Women who wanted to hug me for leading the prayer so well. I was like, hey, bitches, just sit back and clap. I'm not all touchy-feely, especially not with a bunch of broads. I hugged each of them. Over the shoulders of those embraces, I took note and read the faces of the ones who stayed back. I respected them more. I would make a few of them my team. And I now see that one of them was the white woman from the Rally of the Sons who got a whole bunch of bitches to rebel against the Sons on the stage. Excuse me. The corridor captains walked to the front when my fan line ended. Grandmother Maria announced, glory be to the Father. We welcome each of you. Assembled up front are our six corridor captains. I will allow them each to introduce themselves. We will break down into groups, and your captain, who was the first face you saw this morning, will escort you on the tour of our convent, a transitional home to thousands of souls. This is the place where you will each engage in prayer, cleansing your mind and heart. God is good. We are like a spiritual car wash. She laughed at her own humor, except you women are not cars. Give me one second, you guys. Let me wet my whistle. Child trying to rush almost choked to death. All right. The sisters standing beside me are not car wash attendants. But, God willing, you can understand what I mean. Each of us guests tolerated her dumb talk and lined up in front of our corridor captains. You are up there pretending to be sweet, the pretty younger bitch said. Then she laughed. Now we are even. You bit me, I tripped you. She was obviously on my same corridor. Her and the white woman from the rally were both standing with me in Petra's convent tour line. Ladies, please pay attention during the tour. If you don't, it makes more work for me because you will ask me the same questions that I have already answered for the group, Petra said in an even tone. How long have you been here? I asked the pretty bitch. She pulled up her long gray sleeve and checked her lady Rolex. My eyes widened. About six Earth days, long enough to know I am not going to stay, but not long enough to figure out where I'm going to go. You stitched that yourself, she asked as she placed her finger lightly over the embroidery. Bitch, did I tell you you could touch me, I spit? That's the real you, she laughed. Not the bitch up there talking about hallowed be thy name, she cracked up. Ladies, Petra raised her voice as a means of scolding us without scolding us directly. I am about to open the doors to our main prayer hall. You must be completely silent. Inside, there are many praying for their salvation. This is the place where you also will pray for your own salvation and where you will spend the majority of your stay at the convent. Trying hard to be quiet, she opened the door. She was right. It was a sea of women, some sitting with a black book in their laps, some counting a string of beads for some strange reason. Some on their knees facing a statue of that guy bleeding and bound to a cross. Petra led us in single file through the perimeter. She pointed to the colored glass window once we reached the front. It was so dim I could only see the colors, but not the detail of the designs. It had faces, though. Not beautiful faces, but big-eyed people with pitiful expressions. I guess they thought these were scenes that would move a bitch like me to prayer. If I cared enough, I would teach Petra and the other corridor captains and the grandmas a lesson. The key to convincing anybody of anything is by showing them something that is or looks like what they would like to become and who they would be comfortable being. Why break your back praying when this guy at the front is all defeated? I didn't want to end up in his position. Neither did any of these other chicks here, I'm sure. And the chubby pale ladies pictured on the colored glass, I wouldn't trade places with them either. Bible study will begin as soon as the sand at the top of the hourglass reaches the bottom. Petra pointed at it. The tour was over. In addition to showing us the entire facility, Petra had pointed out that there was a 6-foot-tall hourglass placed in each corridor to assist the welcomed new souls, who are often confused about time, to keep on schedule. She also handed out small palm-sized hourglasses to those of us who had not received one yet. Your Bible is in your top dresser drawer. Bring it to Bible study. And for those of you who are eager to learn, like Brooklyn, who learned the Lord's Prayer overnight and who was able to recite it so nicely, you may begin reading your Bible before the Bible study session. Okay, relax until then. See you soon. Petra walked off. Brooklyn, is that your real name? The pretty bitch asked me. I was born in Brooklyn. What section? I followed up swiftly, didn't believe her automatically. East New York, she replied. Where all the action's at, she smiled. Do or die Bed-Stuy, I smiled. That was like throwing an ace on her king. You smoke? I asked her. You cocked? I ain't had none since that nigga, she said, then stopped herself. He's dead, so you and I, let's bury it, I offered. You killed him, she whispered. Never that. I had love for that nigga. He had love for me too, I said. Something inside of me had to let her know that even though she was pretty and younger than I was when it came to that nigga, I was top bitch over every other bitch, including her. That had to be understood and acknowledged before we buried the tension between us. Love, huh? Was all she replied. What room you in? I asked her. 12, she said. You want to come in? I got the smoke. You come by me. I'm in 18. Cool. Give me 5 minutes, though. I'll come way before that. Boring ass Bible study. I'll need the buzz to keep me from feeling like killing myself in that class, she said. And that's the end of chapter 17. So now let me scroll through and see what y'all are saying. So Princess said, "Hey, I can't hear anything. You can't hear me, Princess?" And she said, "Be back." Okay. Love to you as well. Happy all day. All right, let me see. Okay, I'm back. Hello? That's what Princess said. Okay, so Mother said, "Okay, soldier, you have captured Winter's attention." Okay. Petra equals Rose City. I think she meant ENY for East New York. I think that's what she meant. All right, so hey to anybody in the clouds and shrubbery. Hey y'all, hey, please make sure you like the video. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Drop down and say hey. All right, chapter 18. I looked at the candle. It was still burning, but the melted wax was mounting up. I wondered how much time I had left before the flame burnt out completely. I knew I can just request another candle when it did. However, I was in the rhythm of expecting the unexpected. Therefore, I was looking at this lighted candle in the tall jar as the only one I would ever have here at the convent. I needed it to smoke my weed. However, I wasn't going to react to a fear of not having a candle, a match, a lighter, or a flame, then rush and smoke it all before the candlelight expired. That would be too dumb and too painful. I'd be left facing the reality of this realm without it. She knocked. I opened the door. She slipped in. I closed the door and dropped the towel on the floor and kicked it into place, grabbed the chair and tucked it beneath the knob. You can sit on my bed, I told her. She was standing holding a book. It had no words or art on the cover, just heavy black inked parallel lines, like the person who placed them there was pressing the pen too hard. Every four lines, and there was an even heavier fifth stroke crossing the four straight lines out. It was obviously a count. There were more than 60 sets of five. I guess she wasn't lying when she said this is how she kept track of time in the last stop before the drop. She placed it on my dresser and sat down. As soon as I picked up the blunt, stuck my face to the candle jar hole, and blazed up, her eyes danced. I purposely passed the joint right to her. She pulled and puffed. She held on to it, didn't pass it back right away. I was thinking, good. The weed was so powerful, she'd be open in seconds. Name was all I said. Call me whatever you like. We're both dead anyway, she said casually. Well, damn, I said. Even while expecting the unexpected, I didn't expect that reply. What? Are you still in denial? I was too, for about 90 days, she said matter-of-factly. How do you know it was 90 days? How do you keep track of time when there are no mornings, afternoons, evenings, or nights, and no sun, moon, or stars? I asked her. She picked up her pink book. Excuse me. and waved it back and forth. Then she picked up her left hand where she wore her Lady Rolex. I know the time and date of my death. My watch still works. Each 12 hours, I make a mark in my book. Every two marks represents 24 hours. Come on, man. There are 24 hours in a day. So I do simple math, she said casually, while really enjoying the weed. I was replaying her response in my mind. I felt relieved that she must have had that watch on at the time of her death. That means that nigga didn't buy it for her. Now I had less reason to hate her. What about the time you spent as a monkey? I asked her in a non-offensive tone because I really wanted to know. How does she count the time accurately as an animal? Ha ha, I'm glad you put me on to this powerful weed. Only a friend would do that. Otherwise, you reminding me of my time as a monkey would make me think you want to be enemies, she said instead of answering my question. Well, we may be dead, but the way I see it, as long as you have your look and your body, you have life after death. I can see you and how you look. You can see me too. I can see that you have a candle. Light is the hottest commodity in the last stop before the drop. The evil spirits have got the flames. The UBS have got the stars and the mercies. That's their light. The churches have got some light, but it is very dim, like it's on the verge of shutting off. Have you noticed? She asked, blowing out a straight stream of smoke right into my face. I did notice that she was clever at dodging questions, flipping ass, and changing topics. Where did you get the candle? She asked. You must have paid a lot for it. Paid, I said coolly. Is there such thing as money down here? Not your type of money, but you know supply and demand is always the setup. And no matter the world, there is always world trade. You must have sacrificed or traded something for it. Dead humans, whose souls are stuck in the last stop before the drop, are not allowed to have light. She pulled hard on the blunt. This time, the smoke curled up. That's why, if there is a dead human with light, it's either borrowed or stolen, she said, and I was listening carefully. But I ain't seen no police, no courts, no judges, or prisons. That means there's no consequence for a dead human, as you call us, having light just because someone said we are not allowed to have it, I told her. But really, it was a few, excuse me, questions tucked in one statement. Just because you ain't seen something doesn't mean that it is not there, she said strangely. I charged it to the high taking over her mind. Besides, Shaitan got this whole hood on lock. She gestured with her finger, moving it around in the air in the shape of a circle. He hates police, so there ain't none. He runs the red market, travels in more than one world, and comes back with all the shit everybody down here ain't got. Since him and his whole team is all evil, they monopolize the flame. They don't sell or trade matches, lighters, flashlights, candles, or anything that can result in souls being able to see. To the evil ones, those items are considered contraband because they won't allow anything that rivals their flame game. The soul is what they are really after. That's us, by the way. They feed the souls to the eternal fire. How long did it take you to figure something like that out? I asked her. A much shorter time than it took you, she busted out laughing. You still haven't figured it out. She threw salt in the wound she had just cut into me. I must have figured some shit out, I said in controlled anger. You smoking my weed. Apparently, you ain't got none. I got a 7 Series BMW parked out in the blackness somewhere close. I got the hottest commodity, a candle, without paying shit for it. I had a flashlight, which you say we are forbidden to have. I looked at her cheap convent issued slip-ons, and I got Prada kicks, 800 American dollars a pair, a saddlebag, and everything else you don't have. I have a flashlight underneath my bed in my room, she said, all cocky. And I said it is forbidden for dead humans to have light. That doesn't mean we can't figure out how to break the rules. I went to University of Pennsylvania. I should be able to figure out a bunch of shit. I got a super high IQ. Then she added, and I got an iPhone, a bottle of Chanel No. 5 that costs more than your kicks, a Rolex, a corkscrew, and a switchblade, she smiled. A college bitch, I said aloud. But really, I was talking to myself. But you can't be as smart as you think. You couldn't figure out how to stay alive. I trumped her. And you can't make or receive no calls down here on your cell. And no matter how expensive your Chanel is, it's still not strong enough to cancel out the odor that saturates this atmosphere. True that, she answered, flossing her verbal versatility. Now, let's you and I take my flashlight and go get your 7 series. She challenged me. She was calling what she thought was my bluff. I jumped off the bed. Just as I got ready to say, let's go, someone tugged at my door. I put my finger over my lips to tell the pretty bitch to keep silent. Who is it? I'm not dressed, I said through the door. Open up. Excuse me. Open up, or I'll blow your whole cover, a female voice said. She sounded familiar. I waited for her to speak again. I smell it. Open the door, or I'll call the captain, the mother, the father, the grandmother, a team of ghosts, and the goddamn devil, she whispered in forced high voltage words. That's that crazy white bitch. She lives across the hall from you. She's like a fucking protestaholic. Okay, the pretty bitch said, then laughed. Every day she'll start screaming if she doesn't get what she wants. Might as well open it and find out what she wants. I removed the chair and slid the towel away with my foot. I opened up a narrow slit for her to speak through without yelling and exposing us. Give me one pot stick, she demanded, and thrust her hand through the narrow opening. That's all it takes. Then I'll go away. What do you have to trade? I'm not giving you shit for free just because you want it, even if you snitch me out, I told her calmly. What do you need? I asked. I had a list in my mind already, so I called it out. Gasoline, battery-powered radio, batteries, matches, and a lighter. Okay, these notifications are getting on my nerves. No. Sorry. Okay, sorry. Batteries, matches, and a lighter. Some scissors, spools of thread, fabric. Should I continue? I asked her, my tone like a boss and filled with doubt about her competence. She stepped in even closer like a fiend and started sniffing as though she could catch a contact high from the narrow opening in the door while Pretty was still on the bed puffing. How much did she pay to get on? Stay out of my business, I told her. Put up or shut up. I can get gasoline. These nuns got a lawnmower, a pickup truck, and a bus in the garage. Where you get it from and how you get it is your business. Let me know when you got it. Then we trade, but it has to be in a gas can so I can use it. So that's two pot sticks for gasoline and a gas can with the spout. No, get both and you get one. Get one without the other and you get none. Can I get a drag now to hold me over? She asked, reminding me of the crackheads from my Brooklyn block. Back then, everybody knew you have to talk love to them. Get everything they owe you up front or anything you want and need done first before they get a crumb from the rock. They're fiends and liars and thieves. Never trust them. I narrowed the door, crushing her arm. Then I opened it wider so she would know to pull it back and go get my gas. When I shut the door all the way, I turned around and looked at Pretty. I was like, hold up, what do you have to trade for the blunt you haven't passed back to me once? She laughed. That's not the type of deal we made. You have to state the terms of the contract beforehand. I have to hear or read the terms and decide if I want to sign off on it or not. You invited me in here on some type of friendship vibe. Now you want to flip the script after the crazy white chick showed up begging. True that. I know that's how it should be done. So, moving forward, it's all give and take. I don't need to tell you that twice. Just know that's what it is, I said. Cool, I agree, she said. That's mine and your verbal contract. That's valid. She handed me the blunt that was three quarters gone. I owe you one. You helped me get nice before Bible study. Now I won't have to kill myself, she laughed. How about if your car is real, tonight we head to the club. My car is real. After I get the gas, you bring your flashlight and we out, I told her. All right, let me speak to see if anybody new came in. Hey, Foxy Woxy, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Hey, Dana Wayna, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Hey, learning. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. All right, let me keep going. All right, this is annoying. I don't even know how to stop it. All right. All right, let's see. Sister Claire was standing up, teaching the 12 of us seated at Bible study about herself first and the other ones she called sisters, and then attached a name behind it. I thought the bitches were too old and too damn ugly to be called sisters. Grandmas would have been more honest. All of us sisters have taken an oath of poverty, chastity, and obedience, Sister Claire said. An oath of poverty? Come on now. There's not a poor nigga on earth or even down here who would do something like agree from the get-go to be poor and stay poor. That's some mean deception that she's spinning right now. I already didn't trust none of these nuns. Now I was confirmed about it. So, Sister Claire, are you telling us that none of the nuns in this convent have never had any sex? The pretty bitch asked. Sister Claire remained silent for what seemed like a few seconds. Then she calmly answered the pretty bitch back by criticizing her on the low. I want to welcome you and thank you for coming to Bible study today. You have been here at the convent guest house for 7 days now. This is the first day that your soul was moved to join us. Praise God. I'm so thankful to have you. You are right. An oath of chastity means that we refrain from sexual intimacy completely. Once the oath has been taken, from that moment on, we restrain and forbid ourselves and protect ourselves from doing so. Thank you for welcoming me, the pretty bitch said suspiciously politely. So that means some of y'all have been sexually active up until the time before you took the oath. She stared strongly into Sister Claire's wrinkled eyes. I cannot speak for each of the sisters, and I am not sure what you are going after. But for myself, I entered the sisterhood at age 19. I was chaste when I arrived, and I remain chaste to this day. I am 69 years old, she said, and I definitely believe that no man had ever touched her. Seemed obvious. She probably looked just as unattractive when she was young. So she decided to control the action by shutting herself in a place with only women. She already knew the boys wouldn't sweat her. She wanted to reject them before they rejected her homely ass. Thank you, Pretty said. I was only going for the truth, Sister Claire, and you told us that we could ask any question. So I did. And I noticed that you and the other nuns are wearing a ring on your finger. How can you be chaste and married at the same time? Our hearts are captured by the perfect man. Jesus. We are each married to the Lord, she said with seriousness in her delivery. I jumped out of my chair instinctively. Miss Brooklyn, Sister Claire said, as though it was a question. But I wasn't going to tell her that I had leaped up because I had once told my cellmate that Jesus was a pimp and that she, Sister Claire, had just confirmed that it was true. But man, Jesus's pimp hand ain't strong. I mean, he got way more wives than midnight, but the whole stall of them is beat. None of the nuns were the type of bitches that a real pimp would possibly push out on the whole stroll. I laughed at myself. Then I plopped down in my chair without giving any explanation for my behavior. Come on, she had to know. 69 years with no dick, even a thick finger and a strong lick. And on top of that, all the beat nuns are all married to the same dead man. The garment I am wearing is called a habit, Sister Claire said. Yeah, right. Perfect name for the garment. A bad fucking habit, I mumbled for only Pretty seated next to me in the semicircle to hear. The covering on my head is simply called a veil, she said. I was like, no, it isn't. A veil would hide that gruesome face. You wearing a cheap scarf. Then she grabbed the rope around her waist and said, this may resemble a belt to you, ladies. Actually, it is called a cincture. Pretty leaned over and whispered to me, it's an emergency rope for the day she finally figures out she should just hang herself, she laughed. I am sorry if I am not as interesting as you two beautiful souls, Sister Claire said to me and Pretty, but down here, and everywhere really, it is the inside that is most important, not the physical look. She was speaking softly with a fake calm. I would have respected her more if she yelled or threw something or tried to slap some sense into Pretty. That would have been more honest. I'm only saying that because these religious people always be pretending that honesty is their big contribution to the world. Before Pretty could say whatever she was planning to say back, the crazy white bitch busted in Bible study mid-session. She caused all of us to lean back or bend forward. She smelled strong and toxic like gasoline and paint. Sister Claire started coughing. Sister Constance, who was silently observing how Sister Claire conducted the Bible study, stood up. She cleared her throat and said, Miss Bridget, please, let's go out together. Some of the other ladies started saying, ooh, 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 as Sister Constance walked out with her hand on Bridget's back, gently guiding her. I didn't say shit. I know wherever a whole bunch of bitches is gathered and stuck living together around the clock, there's gonna be a bunch of lesbians. It was the same way in prison. I don't judge them though. They mad moody. I mind my business. Don't get in their way unless they get in mine. If they get in my way, then I treat them like any other bitch. I didn't know up until then that the white bitch's name was Bridget, which they pronounce like Brigitte. Perhaps we should refocus, Sister Claire said. She slid one foot forward and started showing and telling us about her horrible sandals. Only thing I was thinking is whether Brigitte would get busted about the gasoline. Did she stash it well, or would she confess to stealing it because her stinking ass gave it away? Or would she deny it and come up with some clever excuse? Sister Claire introduced us to not only the names of her clothing, but to the characters in the Bible. Excuse me. In the Bible that she was set to teach us about by reading selected chapters aloud. A whole discussion broke out when she said Mary was God's mother, but Mary was a virgin. Some of us laughed. Some just sat around looking nervous. Probably the quiet, nervous ones felt bad about catching sexual feelings when they turned teen and for fucking and enjoying it. They probably was the ones also pretending to be virgins, and that's why they suspected Mary of being in the same boat. I don't think people should feel guilty for fucking. That's like feeling guilty for peeing and pooping. It's just something natural we all gotta do. On top of that, Sister Claire said that Mary and a man named Joseph. What nigga gonna let his girl tell him that she's pregnant, but she didn't have sex with him or no other nigga? That's why these type of classes and the people who teach them is all bullshit. I could gather up a crew of hood bitches who got way more exciting but believable stories than the ones in this Bible class. Sister Claire looked flustered. She began distributing one sheet of paper to each of us. I can see my mistake, she said. I can feel that some of you have been so hurt that I was rushing to what I wanted you to learn instead of starting at where you are at. On this paper are the definitions of the following most important things: love, mercy, forgiveness, confession, healing, atonement, and of course, faith. We will begin tomorrow's Bible study discussing love. So let's each take this list to your respective rooms. Think, meditate, pray about what these words really mean. What does each of these words mean to your particular life experience? How can these words, once understood, be used to cleanse the soul? Also, please use each of these words in a handwritten sentence. Write it on the back side of your paper. When I pushed my bedroom door open, Bridget was standing inside of my room. I got ready to punch her in her face for breaking in, but then I saw the gas can, and it was a real one. I walked past her and lifted it. It was full. I thought you got caught, I said to her. I did, she said in all casually. She said it all casually. It doesn't matter if you get caught doing wrong at a convent. Here for these nuns, it's all about forgiveness, she said in a high-pitched mocking voice. They want to save us no matter how long it takes. We are their welcomed guests. These old ladies are non-judgmental, spineless, and so fucking gullible, and I love it. That's why I'm staying here, she paused. Pot stick, please. I delivered your gas in a gas can. I looked at her hard. I didn't trust her. What if the gas in the can is not gas, but paint, which she also smells like, or something else? I'll give it to you after I see if the gas checks out. When it does, our deal is complete. That wasn't a condition, she screamed. That was not a condition, she repeated even louder. That's not right, she yelled. We had a deal. I have a witness. She got hysterical. Look, bitch. You can scream all you want. The rest of my pot sticks are in my car, I lied, and you already gave it away. Even if the sisters here find out that I purchased the gasoline that you stole from them, they'll forgive me. You should have kept that to yourself. Now, go take a shower, comb your hair, and be ready in 30 earth minutes. The protestaholic left reluctantly. I closed the door. The pink notebook was still on my dresser top, with Pretty's death count scratched on not only the cover, but the sides and back of the book, now that I picked it up and took a closer look at it. I opened it up out of curiosity. I am the preacher's daughter. Unless you are also a preacher's daughter, you have no idea what it means or how it feels or what it involves. Even if you are a preacher's daughter, unless you are the bishop's daughter like I am, you have no idea the hellish life I've lived. This is my death story about my life. I didn't turn the page, but I could tell that the worn pages were filled with her heavy-handed writing. I closed the book, wondering why she brought it to my room in the first place, and if she left it here by mistake or on purpose. Well, it doesn't matter, I told myself. I got no time to sit around reading her story. Dead or alive, I'm an action bitch who lives in the present tense.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money. Money, money, money.
Okay. Thank you, happy all day. I appreciate you, lovey. Thank you so much. All right. Let me give me 1 second here. Okay, so that, you guys, was the end of that chapter. Let me see. Let me get back to the book. All right, so what are you guys thinking? Let me see who else has come in since learning did. So Dana was speaking to learning. Hey, organized, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. You guys are speaking, speaking, speaking. Let me see. Hey, Michelle. Welcome, love. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Yes, red balling it at double speed to catch up. Y'all done caught on. I told y'all, if you red ball it back and play it at double speed, like that, you catch up. All right. Hey, Kim Bird. Welcome, love muffin. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. All right. So we are getting ready to start chapter 19. All right. Let me see where we are. Okay, so Pretty was riding shotgun. She couldn't stop laughing. I mean, she was cracking up. It turned out she was the happiest acting person I encountered in the last stop before the drop. Bridget, all clean and fresh, but rocking her gray garment and a cloth bag she called her satchel, was in the back savoring her one pot stick. She didn't offer or pass it around. I didn't care. I got four more to myself. Besides, the car was filled with smoke. Bridget's slow toke of the potent spliff was giving me a light, relaxing buzz. You said you push a 7 series. You left out that it's all fucked up. What happened to your whip? Pretty asked, while still laughing. Don't drive too fast, she warned. The glass fitting up. Wait a minute. Oh, the glass fitting to break out and cut us all into pieces. Pretty still laughing. Just tell me when you turn left or right. Bridget got us all the gas. I'm driving you bitches around. You make sure we get to the club. I'm navigation. I got you, Pretty said, and finally stopped laughing. Club? What club? You didn't ask me if I wanted to go to a club or not. The protester protested. You can cop at the club. They got more than weed. They got everything, Pretty said. That shut Bridget right up. With the promise of more weed, she started pulling like a vacuum cleaner on her pot stick. I'm wearing the convent dress and the sandals, Bridget laughed at herself. She was feeling comfortable now, and her tone was less hectic and aggravating. No big deal, she reassured herself aloud. I'm white. Once they see my natural blonde hair and fair skin, all of the doors will open for me. She sang her words like a song. She believed it too. I wasn't mad at her. I'm top bitch. No reason to stop other bitches from dreaming. What age were you at your TOD? Pretty asked. TOD? Bridget repeated. Time of death. Pretty turned to face Bridget in the back seat and clarified. Pretty seemed too comfortable discussing the death topic that I don't think no one at the last stop before the drop really wants to mention or face. 24. They say the good die young. I guess that's one thing they say that's true, Bridget said, sounding like she was trapped in some memory. How about you? Pretty turned front and asked me. Bitch, how about you? I said, turning the question back at her. 24, Pretty said. 24, me too, I lied, figuring they was probably both lying also. I hear music, Pretty screamed, all excited. Hell yeah, it's pink. get the party started. She was singing the song, but was obviously tone deaf. Win a goal. Follow the flames. We're in the right area. They marked the path to the club entrance, Pretty said, excited, and they did. Turn left. Don't pull up to the front. We gotta park this shit on the darkest side of the street or in a dark alley. Then we'll walk over like we just stepped out of a Rolls Royce, Pretty said, and laughed. The beat shook the building that was lit up by a massive torch with live flames shooting out into the blackened sky. Beneath the torch was a glow-in-the-dark red cage where what looked like a 12-foot-tall red-skinned man with ram horns and 144-foot-long tail paraded back and forth between the bars. Me, Pretty, and Bridget weren't saying shit. We was all looking up at the red beast whose body was all muscle, like the famous muscle dudes in the muscle mags that some chicks on lock enjoy. I didn't get off on those types of magazines. I thought the weightlifters all had shrunken dicks, and that wasn't a good trade-off for more arm and chest muscles, in my estimation. But this red beast had a big, hard, erect, foot-long red dick. The line to get in the club snaked and wiggled because everybody on it was dancing to the most incredible indoor and outdoor sound system. Something wild is happening in the front, Bridget yelled. This time she had to yell. The music was overpowering all, shaking the ground and even making my eardrums vibrate. It's paparazzi, Lady Gaga's song. Maybe she's performing, Bridget screamed. Let's do a train. She threw both of her hands onto my shoulders and pushed me forward. Pretty ran in front of me. Put your hands on my shoulders. We're gonna push, she said. I did, and we were choo-choo. Choo-choo training our way through a moving, dancing mob of hundreds. I didn't give a fuck about seeing Lady Gaga, but I loved the action and the reaction. Some moved out of our way willingly. Some got tight and pushed back. The crowd was so thick that even when we got pushed a few times, we couldn't fall over. Our bodies would just press against some other bodies that were also pressed against some other bodies. We'd rebound and keep it moving. It was mad fun. Pretty ducked low like a football player anticipating a tackle. So we ducked and pushed our final push to the forefront. Pretty's high heel broke upon arrival. She didn't care, just started laughing. There was no celebrity performance. We did all of that pushing only to find out that we were on the request line that led to a circus ring with a thick red rope dangling down in the center of it. No, it was not a rope. It was the tip of the red beast's tail, and dangling from it was a microphone. I'm next, some guy screamed. We're next, some other people screamed. The crowd mashed forward. Some people raced in front of where we were standing, trying to figure it out. They started beating the shit out of each other. The last man standing grabbed the mic and shouted, Maroon 5, Misery. The red beast roared. The track changed tunes. The whole outdoor crowd began to jump up and down, scream, and do some version of a dance. Oh, I get it. Check it out. He's the fucking DJ, Bridget announced, pointing up towards the red guy. Let's go next, she screamed while jumping up and down at the same time. I have a request, she shouted, but the song and the crowd overpowered her for once. Then she took three giant steps forward, waved for us to join her, and squatted like a runner who was waiting for the gunshot to start the race. I'm thinking she must really want to hear whatever song she has in her head. I didn't care enough, though, to start thumping with some strangers over the microphone, and I wasn't about to start rolling on the ground. Even though I wasn't Fendied up or Gucci down, I was wearing that one outfit that I had left to my name, the tapered, mean-ass three-quarter-length pearl-colored Burberry trench and my black Gucci saddlebag and my black Prada kicks. Yeah, I felt bad about it, and it was unlike myself to be wearing a three-piece outfit. But as I got dressed to go to the club, I assured my none of the motherfuckers out partying tonight. It would be their first time seeing me, so my gorgeous look plus my almost brand new fashion would seem fresh to them. The Maroon 5 song was coming to an end. Bridget took off running towards the mic. A lot of others seemed to have her same idea of jump start. They started brawling. Bridget was fighting some white dudes. They were fighting her in her nun garment like she was a man. Her blonde hair and blue eyes didn't tame them like she said it would. One of the dudes grabbed the mic. He shouted, Kings of Leon, you somebody. The red beast roared. The track switched to another song I never heard before. Bridget came back tight. She was finger combing her blonde hair back into place. She reached into her satchel and pulled out a what the fuck camel haired canteen. She began squirting water from it and washing her face clean right there, surrounded by the dancing crowd. "I have something I want the DJ to play," Pretty yelled. She had her heel in her hand. "And I'm about to beat the hell out of somebody. Round two. Let's go for it," Bridget screamed, excited to now have Pretty as backup. "Now I'm thinking, if somebody hits Pretty, I'll have no choice but to start swinging. Brooklyn always fights together with whoever we showed up to the party with. I didn't join Bridget because I thought the white bitch is straight crazy. I couldn't be responsible for her ass. There was no telling what she might do in any given scenario." As the "Use Somebody" track neared its end, a deafening horn sounded and the music stopped. Suddenly, everyone in the crowd divided, leaving me, Pretty, and Bridget at the top, unaware of what was happening. "It's a trick. Let's stay right here. We got next," Bridget said, still scheming on the request mic. But the whole crowd about-faced and began raising and waving their hands in the air. A motorcade came riding through, led by a rose-red Rolls Royce. 12 exotic car doors swung open, but the red Ferrari doors swung out and hung in the air. I felt my pussy pumping. As the must-be top hustlers from the last stop before the drop eased out of their whips, a herd of females ran into the circus ring where me, Pretty, and Bridget had been standing all along. The red beast roared and rattled his cage, causing his tail and the mic to swing back and forth. Pretty dashed to grab it while the crowd, including me, was mesmerized by the car show. Bridget snatched back my focus. She started screaming at Pretty, protesting. See what I mean? Now she was mad at Pretty for beating her to the mic. Every clique knows there's no infighting in public. Now Bridget wanted to fight with her own crew, who she rolled here with. "Rihanna," Pretty screamed into the mic. Just the name alone of that green-eyed superstar bitch jolted the crowd to roar louder than the beast. "Rude boy," Pretty shouted, and the mic amplified her request for all to hear. The crowd cheered the choice. The track began. Pretty moved her body with the alluring fluidness of a belly dancer and a Jamaican dance hall queen mixed. She displayed her ability to hump and ride and fuck the beat. Some of the crowd got caught up into her movements. Others was in a trance to the sound of Rihanna's voice. Others were doing their own style, freak out. Although no matter how wild the crowd danced, pushed, swung, moved, they all seemed somehow to know not to cross the line of the hustlers as they approached the ring. I had my eyes locked in on the hustlers. I was concentrating so hard that my hips only swung a little to the badass sexual beats. I was wishing I had a Cinderella moment as some fairy bitch showed up with some diamond stilettos and an open-backed mini dress made innovatively out of the baddest Hermès scarves, a dress I designed just for this night, and authentic, flawless, glistening jewels and rare limited edition designer accessories. The three of you, the three of you, that makes six. The hustler, who I saw easing out of the Ferrari, said not with his mouth, but with his hands. He had cut through the lineup of cheering, screaming females and stood directly in front of me as Bridget and Pretty were still doing their dances to the left and right of me. He pointed at me, then Pretty, then Bridget, and raised up three fingers. Then he pointed out himself and two other ballers to the left and right of him. I looked them over thoroughly. When I looked at the one talking to me with his hands, I got a bad feeling. That never happened before when I first met any person, no matter their status. He must have thought, since I wasn't saying nothing back, that I didn't understand his offer. He stepped in close to me and said, "I choose you." Without warning, even from myself, I vomited right in his face. Pretty stopped dancing and her jaw dropped open. The music stopped. The goop slid down onto his expensive attire. The two hustlers with him did a 180 and grabbed two other begging chicks from the crowd who were still eagerly waving their hands in the air and cheering to be chosen. Now I was doubled over. I heard Pretty say to him, "She's sorry. She must have gotten car sick from our drive over. Either that or she doesn't choose you," Bridget said and cracked up. The nigga cocked back his hand and open smacked Bridget. I stood up but felt dizzy. Bridget slapped him back, then pushed him. The crowd closed in. "I wasn't talking to either one of you," he lied, pointing to me and Bridget. I was speaking to the young pretty thing, he said, nodding in the direction of Pretty. As he attempted to step close to Pretty, Bridget cut him off. He then snatched Bridget's arm and twisted it behind her back. That was a wrong move. If he knew Bridget, he would have cuffed or gagged her mouth. That's her weapon. We hate, we hate, we hate, we hate men who beat women, Bridget called out like a rallying cry. She broke free and began screaming. We hate, we hate, we hate men who beat women. On the microphone, she was screaming confidently, as though she knew there had to be at least 300 other women in the crowd who also hated men who beat women. Soon, a chorus of voices were chanting, we hate, we hate, we hate men who beat women. Then some of the men who were in the request line began beating the hustler who had been twisting Bridget's arm. The crowd began cheering for the guys that were mobbing and mopping up the hustler whose face I vomited in. But the beast must have gotten angry. He roared so loud, flames of fire shot down from his mouth. Some of the fighters caught on fire. Some of the people tried to put the fire out. Instead of it going out, it grew larger and spread wider. Then a deafening horn went off like a horn on an amplifier. The horn caused people to cover their ears and scatter. Out from the flames came a man who could only be described as irresistible. He was light-skinned. Usually I'm powerfully attracted to men who don that deep black skin color. This hustler was more the complexion of my father. He had silky black hair, but cut it low, faded the sides, and was sexy physiqued and immaculate. It was as though the crowd recognized or respected him. When everybody saw him, they stopped doing everything and anything they had been doing. His walk was rhythmic, yet perfectly calm and humble, like a boss who never needs to get agitated because he runs it. He didn't have the overplayed swag of the hustlers who arrived before him. From his had-to-be-bespoken suit, because of the way it fit his muscles and the contour of his body, he pulled out a handkerchief and extended his hand to me. When I didn't react naturally or quickly enough because I was hypnotized by the gleam of his clean diamond cufflinks, he began using it to wipe my mouth with his right hand while grabbing the mic with his left. I'm the owner of this club, he said into the mic with calm seriousness. You are all my guests. He gestured toward the attentive crowd. They cheered. I train my staff to exhibit superior customer service, unmatched guest relations, and, below all, common sense. This fool here is my son. He's a son of a bitch and a demon. He placed his foot on his son's stomach as he lay beaten and broken on the ground in the rain. Apologize, he said, pressing further into his son's abs. His son's face turned even more hateful. For what? She's the bitch who vomited on me. The irresistible father moved his Gucci driving shoe onto his son's neck, apologized to her for making her feel sick to her stomach, then apologized to the noisy one for your unnecessary violence, then apologized to the pretty young thing for making it impossible for her to accept your invitation, he said as he carefully lifted his shoe from his son's throat and downshifted the mic to him so that his apology could be heard. Forgive me, forgive me. Forgive me, his son said, hatefully, three times. I guess that was the best he could do. He stood up. He dusted off the ash and soil from his attire. Sorry, father, for ruining the night, he said, like only a son apologizing to his father could say. An unrelated nigga would have never apologized, even if he was 100% certain that he was dead wrong. Niggas would have just fought or shot it out till everybody and possibly even the crowd, except for one, was all dead on the floor. His son dropped the mic. The father caught it smoothly and stepped my way. My taste is more immaculate than my son. I choose you. You're the finest choice, he said, and his words were amplified for all to hear, no matter how far off they were from the club. I was publicly crowned. I was won over. He just confirmed my top bitch status, even though I wasn't donned and dolled up in my fiercest fashion. I was won over in that second. What do you say? Do you choose me back? He smiled as though he already knew my answer. The crowd cheered. Say yes, say yes, say yes. I saw Bridget in the crowd screaming, say yes, say yes, with as much passion as she protested or cheered for anything. She could have been screaming, toilet paper, toilet paper, toilet paper, and she would still be screaming it with the same resolve, enthusiasm, and force. The thought made me laugh. When he saw my smile, he took it as a yes. At the same time, my eyes landed on Pretty. She was watching closely, not cheering or laughing. If, I answered, whatever your if involves, I agree. If you say, allow all of these people into my club for free, I agree. The crowd went haywire. Now it was a different type of pressure. It didn't matter. He had everything he needed to have me. Pretty dashed and grabbed the mic. But what does she have to give if she, if she's agrees? Why does it say if she's agrees? Sorry. What's the terms of the contract? She asked sweetly, with what felt like a deep concern for me. But the wild crowd booed her. Wall-to-wall boos. The club owner waved Pretty over, like how a boss waves over a worker. Then he waved his hand one time, commanding the crowd to silence. A gentleman only offers and never forces a woman to do anything that she does not approve of. These are the only words in my contract, he said to Pretty, but really to everyone. He extended the mic to her lips. I intercepted the mic. Deal, I said calmly. Free entry for all the clubbers. And the drinks are on the house, I added, snatching back the spotlight and feeding the momentum in my favor. The whole entire outdoor crowd went buck wild. Pandemonium. Go get my whip, he said to his son. What about my car? I drove the Ferrari here, his son said. His father just stared at him. The pupils of the father's eyes turned red. The son went to fetch the vehicle without further hesitation. His father signaled his suited men, who I just noticed scattered about in the crowd. I liked the way he commanded the situation so smoothly and didn't panic or respond to the wildness that surrounded him. He pulled back the mic. Music. DJ, spin. All I do is win. And when he said the track title, he did a one-step dance move, like I seen my father do back in the day at certain moments when he had to be too cool to dance. The red beast roared and the cut came on at his command. I loved it. His choice pushed out pop and put hip hop back into play. The rose red Rolls Royce rolled up. He flicked his finger. His son got right out. He waved his son off like a man swatting a fly. I have something to say, his son said. The father ignored. Instead, he opened the front passenger side door and waved me in. I need my girls to ride with me. That was the if I was talking about, I said to him. He waved Pretty over. She was standing and watching me, held her heels in her hand, walked over in her bare feet and climbed in back. I looked around for Bridget, but didn't see her in the dancing crowd that was lining up to enter the club. I should have known that Bridget would run off somewhere in search of her next outburst. The fair-skinned one is already seated, he gestured. She seems to like Olga, my secretary, he added slyly. I dipped and looked in the back. Bridget, in her nun garment, was hugged up with some tall but petite-framed European model-style woman who, on first glance, I saw was wearing $3,000 heels. Bridget shrugged her shoulders like, whatever. Now we were rolling in the rose-red Rolls Royce. He was driving. I was chilling while falling in love with the white leather captain's chairs with the deep red piping. The whole beauty of this vehicle had me melting. My girls behind me were holding crystal wine glasses as his secretary poured the drinks. She passed the first half-filled glass to me. I was like, that's right, bitch. Keep everything flowing in the right order, and I'll let you keep your job. Maybe. By the time this night comes to an end, I better be wearing shoes double the value of the pair she had on. I'd make him prove himself to me over and over again, not through his charm-filled words, but through action. That's the way I measure a man. On the dash, right in front of me, was a thin, pure gold case. I leaned forward and opened it. Help yourself. It's my business card, he said, granting permission, but I was already on it. The card was all black and made of expensive fabric. Strangely, there was no business address or phone number or even an email address. It contained only a finely embroidered, slanted capital letter E, enlarged and positioned in the center of the card. I flipped it over. The backside was just pure black with one sentence written at the bottom edge in fancy tiny white lettering. It read, "One night only." "Ask me anything," he said, sensing my curiosity. I was imagining going into the club tonight, getting VIP seats, or yes, Drinks on the house, a few celebrity sightings. I was thinking of all my favorite dead celebs that might be performing at the club. I laughed to myself. I wondered if the stars have to be dead to perform in the city called the last stop before the drop, or if they could be booked from the world of the living and required to sign a confidentiality agreement like I learned about from preparing for my reality show debut. As long as they never told one living human about, yes, one living human being. About the realm of the living dead and the fact that rest in peace is a sham, would they be allowed to perform at his nightclub? The unexpected that I had not imagined so far was way better than the expected. I dropped the card into my saddlebag. I had so many questions. I didn't ask him anything, though. Wherever we were going next, as we cruised through the darkness, was better than returning to my little room for one in a convent with a bunch of ugly broke bitches who were determined to stay broke forever. And that's the end of chapter 20. So let me see who has happened to come into the speakeasy while I was reading. All right. So Black Diamond said, Soldier is slowly drawing winter into the fold, even though winter is still rebellious. Child, winter is not caring. Mother. Yes, you guys. Please remember to hit that like button if you haven't already. All right, let me see. Let me see. I'm trying to read. I have to make sure I pay attention. Hey, Cindy White. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Let me see. Let me make sure. Let me see. Hey, Evil. That's my sniper in the ghillie suit. Welcome, darling. Child, where am I here? Hey, Mimi. She said, hi, everyone. I'm listening while I'm on my way to work. All right, now. Thank you for sliding through the speakeasy, honey, while you're on your way to work. We appreciate you. All right, so let me wet my whistle, you guys. All right, that's three chapters in 1 hour and 16 minutes. I know you lying. All right, let me keep going. All right, so chapter 20. Laid out on the spa table, having our bodies gently scrubbed with loofah sponges and fragrant soaps, it couldn't be better. When we arrived curbside, we were greeted by an attractive older woman. She came secretly over to the driver's window with a very attentive and familiar expression upon seeing him. When his window lowered, she spoke to him in a strange language. Even stranger, he spoke back to her in the same sounding language, but his talk was way beyond simple greetings. He looked over to me, placed his hand on my arm, then turned back to her. I could only guess that he was telling her to care for me properly. He looked back where Bridget and Pretty were comfortably seated, along with his secretary. Then he turned back to the attractive older woman and spoke some more. She listened with a knowing, pleasant smile on her face, then stepped to the back of the rooms. Olga eased out as though she had fully understood their conversation. He eased out too, and to my surprise, walked around to open the door, only for me. I have to finish up some business matters at the club. By the time you ladies are satisfied here, I will have return to escort you to Pharaoh's. Pharaoh's? I replied, but really it didn't matter. I was down to go wherever. The lighthouse. It is my private place, my estate, where I welcome only the most selective special guests. I smiled, or he smiled rather, Lord who? He smiled, gave me his arm, and escorted me to the front of the establishment. Once I was standing beside my girls, he checked his goddamn hot to death rose gold Audemars. Listen, that P watch that Migos be talking about. I can't think of the name of it, but y'all know what I'm talking about. That watch. Diamond flooded watch. I was swooning as he walked back to his whip. Take deep breaths, Pretty said, and laughed a little. This way, ladies, the older attractive woman guided. Olga followed first. We followed Olga, but Bridget bolted forward so that she could walk beside Olga. What amazing language was that? Bridget asked Olga. Amharic, Olga replied. It is the language of Ethiopia. No, that it was, you know what? It wasn't. Patek. It was something, child. I don't know. Maybe she don't know how to spell Patek. That's what I'm saying. I thought it had to be that. Wait a minute. Let me see. We have come upon a word that Saki does not know how to pronounce. I don't know. Rose gold. I don't know. Maybe she spelled this word wrong. But it says rose gold Audemars PI. What in the world? PIGUET. Something, child. Listen, some kind of diamond flooded watch. Who give a damn? They all did anyway. Moving on. Anyway, it don't matter, child. So anyway, so she said they were speaking Amharic. Olga replied, "It is the language of Ethiopia, my country." The attractive older lady stopped to say proudly. Three young Ethiopian maid servants serviced us. Olga was in charge of assuring that we received the royal treatment. I was glad that it was just us three receiving the works. If Olga had also been laid out on the table, then I would have known that she was not really a secretary, but maybe as a secret side piece. Hopefully, not more. Do you think he's married? Bridget asked me as our soap bodies were being gently hosed down with warm water. No, probably just divorced. Didn't you hear him say outside the club that his grown son was a son of a bitch? He wouldn't say that about his wife, so whoever his son's mother is, either just some jump off baby mama or tired ex-wife he's no longer interested in. Son of a bitch. Yep, he definitely did call his own son that, Pretty added. Well, I hope he is divorced. I hate a scumbag who cheats on his wife. I really hate it, hate it, hate it. Bridget was getting revved up. Relax, the Ethiopian girl who was serving Bridget said softly. Bridget had raised her head up and tensed up her back muscles just by thinking about my guy's marital status. Me too, Pretty said. I hate adultery. It hurts. Ah, bitch, you were fucking that nigga same time I was, I said too quickly. That's not adultery, Pretty said. You were not married to him. And as far as I know, based on what he said, he was not married to anyone either. If single people fuck each other, that's not adultery. That's called fornication. Fornication, huh? What no dick having, no pussy having idiot came up with a dry ass word like fornication to describe coming so hard that your thighs tremble, I said, and we all laughed. I was glad they didn't front like they couldn't understand where I was coming from. Suddenly, the Ethiopian maid servants were laughing too. All right, give me one second. Ooh, doggy, that's hot. Okay. Our bodies washed, scented, and oiled. We were receiving mani-pedis simultaneously from the now six new servants who were serving us in the same building, but separate salon room. I thought it was dope how it was one wide, one-story building that accommodated all of a woman's needs. I had a thought while seated in the comfortable, elevated salon chairs. How did you find out about that club? It sounded like you had been there a few times before. Yeah, and you even knew the way, I asked Pretty. Because I went once before, she said softly, as though she didn't want to discuss it. That wasn't your first time seeing that beautiful red god in the sky playing the music, Bridget asked. Then there was a pause before Pretty replied. I didn't get that far to the front of the club. I was on the back end of the line, two or three blocks over. That's how I knew the club just had to be lit. You know, it's like a great restaurant. It could be small like a closet, but if the food is exceptional, there will still be 3 miles of people waiting for a taste. Or a restaurant can be fine and fabulous, totally upgraded, but completely empty because of who or what's cooking, or who's serving, and how they look, and also how they treat the customers, stuff like that. So I knew the club had the right formula, everything working right at the right same time. So, what happened once you got to the front of the club? Was there a different DJ than the one we saw tonight? Bridget demanded to know, but I had already figured it out. I met a guy while I was on that long line just enjoying the music. We could hear it even 3 blocks away. Well, anyway, the guy pushed a black Lamborghini. He pulled up right beside where I was standing. He gets out, and all the girls were checking him. Even the men were fascinated with his whip, and out of the sea of women gathered there, he chose me. Same like tonight, Bridget exclaimed, and because she was all reflexes, she caused the polish on one of her toes to get nicked. I didn't say nothing. I knew that was the day Pretty had first met that nigga. She knew my feelings and my bond with him. So she was either nice enough or clever enough not to bring him up by name. And I know he rocked her bells, same as he rocked mine. While our nails dried, we were served in tiny little colorful clay cups, sips of the best coffee ever. I'm not really a coffee drinker, but I got a bit curious from the aroma and was impressed at having a servant hold the tiny cup for me until I sipped. It was the first drink I had as a dead human. The fact that they offered it to us made me feel alive. I like that. The pastry that accompanied the coffee was the size of a coin. I thought it was clever to offer guests the best cake they would ever taste in life or death, and to only give them enough for them to leave with a delicious memory and a continuous craving. Seemed like he would have to return to this exact location to experience the exquisite taste. I'm sure that was the whole point. Beyond my sexual enticement, I was getting pretty pumped about the business possibilities this new connect would open for me. I could do what any of the women working here could do. I could do it even better. Upon arriving in the next salon in the same spa, I became skeptical about letting some Ethiopian girls who were still foreign bitches to me do my hair. Even though the hair salon was crystal clean, I don't choose beauticians by how sparkling their salons are. I choose based on reputation, hearsay, and technique. Once I choose a beautician bitch, she gets one chance to make one mistake. Then I'm out, never again to return, and I'm telling everybody not to go there. Here, madame. The maybe 21 years young beautician set to do my hair handed me a Vogue, a Cosmopolitan, an Elle, and a Black Hair magazine. I was so thrilled to see magazines, period. I could have peed with joy. I didn't know. I grabbed hold of them and knew they were going to be taken with me to wherever my next stop is. I looked at the date on the front cover. These mags came out after my death. Choose a style. I think you may be particular, she said demurely. We are particular too, and we do a great job, she said pleasantly, striking a confident pose. Better than the Dominicans, I asked, just to fuck with her, but she didn't know who the Dominicans were. I flipped through the pages, taking my sweet time. I settled on a shortcut that I saw on top model Linda Evangelista. Only the prettiest bitches have the confidence to pull off a short, wild cut. With my skin back in flawless condition, my scar gone like it was never ever there, I was as cocky as Naomi Campbell and as sultry as Chanel Iman. So I went for it. You got a mirror? I asked when my cut was complete. What for? The young Ethiopian beautician asked, then smiled. Then she pointed. The mirror was right in front of me. And even though I was seated in her chair and she was standing next to me, neither one of us cast a reflection. Trust me, you are more gorgeous than all of the bitches in the magazines. I'm counting on your look to win me a promotion, a bonus, and a reward. All three. The two of you, the dark-eyed, dark-haired, older Italian woman who was introduced to us as the top hostess who runs the fashion wing of the spa building, said, speaking to Bridget and Pretty, may select two dresses and two pantsuits. You are limited to salon rooms. A and B. You, my dear, follow me. So I did. She was like an old beauty pageant winner who walked as though she still had her crown on her head. Traces of beauty were there, but obviously terminally faded. She swung open a heavy door. Inside were the designer's top pieces from all over the world. As my eyes zoomed from left to right at each item, I thought of how I didn't really have enough places to go down here to wear these type of fuck the world, I'm rich bitch styles. I smiled. Enjoy it while it lasts, she said, but sounded a little greasy, even with her thick accent. How many can I select? I asked, ignoring her little swipe. For you, it is unlimited. Choose anything you like. I will package it for you. She didn't have to tell me twice. I was like a greedy fat bitch in a chocolate shop. I strolled calmly, even though I was overjoyed and overwhelmed. I paused as though I had to think about certain items when there was absolutely nothing to think about. I'm taking it all. From the look on her face, I guess she thought I overdid it. Everyone forgets the nightclub is called One Night Only, she said strangely. Yeah, what about it? I asked her sharply, letting her know I'm top bitch right now, not 30 years ago. Even if this is a one-night shopping event, that's even more reason to grab everything while I can. You chose 15 dresses, 6 skirts, 10 blouses, 8 scarves, 6 silk robes, and go package them. Do your job. I cut her off. Which one will you wear to the club? She asked slyly. Depends on how I feel and how I want to look at that time, I said, which was my super polite way of saying, bitch, mind your fucking business. Sophia, she called out. A younger woman emerged from behind a curtain. Package these, the old bitch said. All but one outfit will be returned. Either way, she added. I just ignored her, crossed my arms across my breast, and tapped my foot like, run, bitch, hurry up. You didn't select any undergarments, she said deviously. I don't wear any, I said it old school like, how you like me now? Bridget and Pretty came looking for me at the designer shoe shop. I'm glad they showed up because I was never coming out on my own. Being in there was like a tongue licking my clitoris. I was turned on by everything I saw. Who owns this shop? I asked the French hostess who served me, the only customer at the moment. Why do you ask? Well, you have a pair of shoes in a glass showcase over there that are selling for more than $1 million. Oh, yes, yes. Stuart Weitzman loves to design this multi-million dollar shoe collection. He is show off with diamonds and rubies and gold and emeralds. So whoever owns this spot is so caked up he could afford a 7 or 8 digit shoe inventory, she smiled. You know him. He is the one who made it possible for you and I to be here, she said, as though she and I were sharing some secret. Oh, word, he owns the shoe store? I double-checked. He owns the entire building, the whole spa, and all of the businesses on this street, plus more. How did you get this job? I asked her. I knew it was bold and that she might tell me to mind my fucking business, the same way I tell people that all the time. But instead, she said, how does a woman get anything she wants from a man? Then she stared into my eyes as though she and I would finish off our conversation speaking only through our eyes. After a long pause, she said, whenever you want something from a man, satisfy him. She winked. And don't keep him waiting. She nudged me to join Bridget and Pretty, who were waiting at the exit. And that is the end of chapter 20. All right, you guys. So, yes, 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 to all the things, yes. So listen, hey, Roxy's Lady Lounge. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. So yes, no, it wasn't a Patek, child. I don't know what it is, but whatever it is, child, it's one of them watches. All right, so Black Diamond is telling us that Pharos, a large Hellenistic lighthouse built on an island off Alexandria in Egypt in about 280 BC. Okay. All right, all right, all right, all right, all right, all right. Oh, Pujway. Child, listen. Listen. Listen, we got listen, Shaitan, child, too much, too much, too much. So, Pujway. A swish lux swish. What the fuck? A Swiss luxury watch. I give up, child. I'm dead, but not dead like winter, though. All right, so Black Diamond said, hey, just pass through your area. Okay. All right. Yes, 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 yes. Okay, thank you for dropping Roxy's Lady Lounge. Yes, we support Black women over here. Go sign up. Sign up. Not sign up, damn it. Subscribe, child. Subscribe, subscribe. All right, so listen, y'all. I was hoping that I'd finish up, earlier and be able to slide in another chapter. Because listen, after reading these four here and the next four in about 41 minutes, provided I get out of here on time, which I doubt I will, but I'm still coming back at 6:45, probably more like 7 o'clock. I wanted to do an extra chapter or whatever have you, because after I do the next set of four today and then two sets of four tomorrow, child, do y'all know that there is only two chapters left? Just two. Yes, just two. That's it. And then we gonna be done with this one, y'all. And that was really, really fast. So, and we would have been done, but of course, I didn't read the other day. All right, so check it out. I'm out of here. Thank you guys for coming out, and we'll see you next week. No, I'm just y'all know what that's from. So okay, I'll be back at 6:45, 6:50, since I'm 5 minutes late leaving, and that's all y'all's fault because I was talking to y'all. So listen, y'all be good. Thank you again. Happy all day for my Cash App, darling. I appreciate you, lovey, and the rest of y'all. Y'all know y'all could tip y'all content creator or whatever, child. Anyway, I'll see y'all when I get back. Thank you, moderators, for keeping us safe in the speakeasy. And y'all, please salute your spirit, protect your peace, and have your ass in the space at 6:45, 6:50. Okay? All right. Bye, y'all. Now look at this little baby coming in here late. Hey, Carol MG. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. We'll be back at 6:45, 6:50.